We're on a mission from God.
And now for something completely different.
Yeah.
This is Pastor Jolly John Lekumsky, and I have with me
Pastor Matt Youngblood Clark.
Yes, almost a doctor.
Almost is the key word there, John. Almost.
But it's getting closer. It's getting closer. Hopefully a year from now we will be able to say Dr.
Lord
Matthew
will.
Clark. You know, a couple of weeks ago, Lynn set a standard for us for jokes this year. And I just, it's going to be hard for us to keep up with the Shirley Goodnest and Marcy shall follow me. But I have a few here. I have a few I think that might. So just you tell me whether these are on the same level as that joke we had.
Okay. All right. Lay it on us, John.
What did the policeman say to his belly button?
We're off to a great start, aren't we, John? I can't imagine the punchline. What did the policeman say to his belly button, John?
You're under a vest.
Okay, yeah.
This is a classic. This is a classic.
All right.
But you know what? What's brown and sticky? What's brown and sticky?
I think I know, but I'm going to ask you, John. No, what is brown and sticky?
Yes, but what is brown and sticky? Come here, you know this one.
A stick?
It is a stick.
That is
a classic. Yeah. Here's one for you as a father. When does a joke turn into a dad joke?
Ooh, I don't know. When does a joke turn into a dad joke?
When it becomes apparent. When it becomes apparent.
No, I'm going to share that with my daughter. She loves the dad jokes.
She doesn't
admit to it, but our 15-year-old loves the dad jokes.
You can't admit to it. No. They don't want to encourage that, but inside they are laughing.
Oh, I know, every time. One
more here. Why are teddy bears never hungry? Why are teddy bears never hungry?
Why aren't they?
Because they're always stuffed. They're always stuffed.
It only makes sense.
Oh, and I have to have two more. I'm just looking over the list here. Why do seagulls live by the sea?
Because if they live by the bay, they would be bagels.
Oh, you know that one.
I know that one. And it's a good one. I like it. It's good.
It's a good one. I'd never heard that one. And here's one for you know, I'm an organist. I'm a music lover. So here's one for all the music lovers who listen to our show. What do music and chickens have in common?
I have no idea.
Bawk, bawk, bawk.
Bach is rolling over in his grave at that one, John.
Yes. Oh, that's the other one, of course. Oh, we'll do that another time. Remind me to tell you the joke about Bach in his grave. But we need to get on to something more worthwhile
here.
The
good news is, John, you know, in 2023, the jokes can only get better, right?
That's right.
So keep listening,
folks. It's got to improve.
Don't give up on us. You're wrestling with the basics.
That's right. So we're talking about sons. We're talking about sons, and you are a parent, and I am a parent, and that's why our jokes are horrible. But we talked about Absalom, who was the son of David, who was obviously just a bad seed. You know, leading a rebellion against his father. And then you were telling us, though, about the good son, you know, Solomon, the son who wanted wisdom, and he wants to fulfill his dad's dream. His dad's dream was to build the temple, and Dad, I'm going to do that for him. I'm going to build the temple. So what else did you want to tell us about Solomon, the son of David?
Yep. So far, so good, right? Yeah, wisdom and the writing of three different books of the Bible, at least much of those books, right? And we have those neat accounts where Solomon demonstrates his wisdom before the Queen of Sheba, even, who comes to visit him. His wisdom so famous. How he also decides that one case, remember, between the two mothers, the two prostitutes, whose one baby had died and the other one was still living, and they each claim that the one living baby was theirs. And remember, David says, well, divide the child in two. Oh, that doesn't sound very wise. Until the mom, whose child it really was, protests and says, no, don't kill the child. Just give her to the give the child to the other woman. And of course, then Solomon determines that's the real mother. You know, wow, what a wise decision. So far, so good. We marvel at his wisdom, I think. And rightly so, that God give him wisdom. Remember, as the Lord says, you ask for whatever you want, and he asks for an understanding heart. But then Solomon does something stupid.
Really?
He's still an imperfect
He followed my
God.
Model? Yeah, you know, Matt, that's my daily goal. Every day I want to do at least one stupid thing because I like to set goals that I can achieve.
There you go.
So,
set the bar low. So Solomon, even all of his wisdom and, you know, really at the height of his reign, again, Israel bigger, better, richer than it's ever been in its entire history ever would be, still is imperfect. So we have a description of what takes place here. Really, it seems to be at the apex, right, of Solomon's reign. We hear about that in 1 Kings chapter 11. And if you could read verses 1 through 8, John, as we hear this account of what Solomon does next.
Yep, and thank you for having all the difficult words in there, too. I appreciate that, Matt.
Yeah, you
bet. Okay.
You get to read about concubines.
Now, King Solomon loved many foreign women, along with the daughter of Pharaoh, Moabite, Ammonite, Edomite, Sidonian, and Hittite women from the nations concerning which the Lord had said to the people of Israel, you shall not enter into marriage with them, neither shall they with you, for surely they will turn your heart after their gods. Solomon clung to these in love. He had 700 wives who were princesses and 300 concubines, and his wives turned his heart. For when Solomon was old, his wives turned away his heart after other gods, and his heart was not wholly true to the Lord his God, as was the heart of David his father. For Solomon went after Ashtoreth, the goddess of the Sidonians, and after Milcom, the abomination of the Ammonites. So Solomon did what was evil in the sight of the Lord, and did not wholly follow the Lord as David his father had done. Then Solomon built a high place for Chemosh, the abominations of Moab, and for Molech, the abomination of the Ammonites, on the mountain east of Jerusalem. And so he did for all his foreign wives who made offerings and sacrifice to their gods.
Thanks, John. Yeah, lots of, yes, difficult words, but well worth reading, because I think we can really learn from these words here in Scripture. And really, when you think about this, these are some of the saddest words in Scripture. You know, here is, again, Solomon, the Lord's chosen guy to be king, the wisdom that God blessed him with, and even still, it's clear he turns away. Again, verse 4, for when Solomon was old, his wives turned away his heart after other gods. His heart was turned away from the Lord. Ugh, you know, how sad. But what happens is he has these 700 wives, 300 concubines, and, you know, granted, most of these marriages are probably political ones in nature, right? Political alliances with surrounding nations. We even hear those nations listed off. But even still, that's not okay. This is not a case for polygamy, multiple spouses. No, that's still not God's intention even there. Solomon is doing wrong. No, God's model for marriage from the beginning, one man and one woman like Adam and Eve. So even there, Solomon's going off the rails. But in addition to that, his wives, again, turn his heart to other gods. And then enlist some of those other gods, even by name. I think that's kind of interesting. And maybe one of the reasons the text does this is because these are some of the worst of the foreign gods. I mean, no idol worship is good, right? But Even still, these are some of the worst of the worst. He worships Asherah here, the goddess of the Canaanites, kind of the consort of Baal. And then this Milcom, who's mentioned here, otherwise known as Molech, the god of the Ammonites. Really a bad one. That's an idol, a statue that people would actually sacrifice their very own children to. And you wonder if Solomon even did that himself, sacrificed some of his children to this idol. So, yeah, it's clear. You know, Solomon, it seems, from what's been revealed here, you know, turns away from the Lord.
I noticed, Matt, that the word abomination is repeated three times there, and that obviously emphasizes what you said, that this isn't just not idol worship, but these are people that do the exact opposite of what God has commanded his people to do. So,
yeah, for sure. Yeah, this is just not some benign, you know, oh, it's not so bad type thing, or, you know, just add a little worship of false gods to the worship of the true God. No, this is, that's bad in and of itself. This is an abomination to follow anyone, to break the first commandment, to follow anyone other than the true God. And then, you know, the worship of these false gods in particular, especially detestable. The sacrifice of children even. Oh, just evil. So, you know, again, you know, we ended our episode yesterday by you asking, well, what does this have to do with us? And we always want to ask that, I think. You know, anytime we hear God's word and listen to Wrestling the Basics or even a sermon, how does this apply to me?
Because obviously, Matt, I don't have 700 wives and 300 concubines. Okay. So if that's the problem here, it doesn't have anything to do with me.
You're pretty clear, John.
I'm doing good
too.
Just to take care of one wife. Right. Yeah. Yeah.
And, you know, and the Lord's bless us with wonderful God-fearing women, you know, who aren't leading us astray into worship.
Yeah,
other,
yeah,
other foreign
exactly.
Gods.
That's a good analogy. That. Yeah,
oh,
yeah.
How important.
Get
that
yourself a good wife. Yeah.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. Have a faithful spouse. But what we can learn here is, if Solomon of all people, the one who had this wisdom, the one who was God's chosen one to be king of Israel, if he of all people can be turned away, well, guess what? So can we. We can turn away from the Lord too. We have that ability to turn away from the Lord, to close our ears to his word, to chase after other false gods, whether they're literal idols or false religions, or maybe it's just other things that we love it more and trust in more than God himself. You know, if Solomon can be turned away from the God, boy, you know, so could we. So could we. You know, so I think one thing to learn here is just to heed this warning, to not pridefully think that we're immune to sin, or that we're immune from maybe, you know, even turning away from God. You know, that we don't need to come to worship, we don't need Bible study, we don't need whatever, we're immune to it. Or maybe that we're immune from certain sins in our life. You know, my marriage is hunky-dory. You know, there's no way I would ever be unfaithful to my spouse or ever have an affair with my wife. Or you know, there's no way, you know, that I would ever let money or my job get in the way of God or be put above him. You know, we sometimes think about those things. You know, after all, I'm listening to Wrestling with the Basics on KFUO Radio. I'm a good Christian. There's no way I would fall to these sins. When any time that we think those things, boy, yeah, remember Solomon. Have him in the back of your mind. You know, if Solomon can be led astray and sin greatly, we can be led astray. We can sin greatly too. So I think the thing to learn from Solomon, one of the things to take away is, you know, avoid pride. Avoid pride in thinking that we're somehow immune to sin.
You know, Matt, the thing that strikes me is how the heart is mentioned repeatedly, and his wives turned away his heart. And in fact, the reason why you don't enter into marriage, the Lord had said, was because they will turn your heart after their other gods. And his heart was not like the heart of his David the father, and his heart was not wholly true to the Lord the God. And you had the heart passage from, I don't know if it was last week or 2 weeks ago, the heart passage of Jesus, out of the heart comes, and he lists all these possible things. And the realization that's true of all of us. We may be good at keeping external things under control. I've never been unfaithful. I've never slept with another woman. But you know, the lust, the heart, it's still there. I cannot claim that I haven't looked at another woman and said, va, va, voom, or whatever you young people say nowadays. So that's the realization that even if we could, even if we could say we've kept the externals under control, the fact of the matter is that sinfulness is still part of our lives. And I think what happens is the Lord says, oh, yeah, you've got that under control, do you? And then he just, he puts us to the test, and we begin to see that no, those sins are still a reality. And for me particularly, I guess the thing that he always tests me, not so much about the whole sexual thing like we have here with King Solomon, because I'm an old guy, and that really does change as you get older, Matt. But the whole trust thing, I think that's the thing he's always testing me with, how quickly it is for me to doubt that he's going to take care of me or resolve whatever the issue might be, whether it be something small or large. And that's okay. That's a good thing, like you said, because I think pride is... Well, consider the Pharisees, Matt. Don't you see their big problem? They didn't do a lot of mean, nasty things, at least that you could say for sure. Mm-hmm. We think they probably did do a lot of things in the background with widows, mites, and their money and what have you. But anyway, now I'm rambling. But the point is they were proud of that, and that would lead to their downfall.
Yes, and it's a great illustration is when it comes to Jesus, then when he arrives on the scene, some people reject him, right? And among those are Pharisees and others who would be the very people, boy, they should recognize this is the Messiah. But, you know, their pride, I think, blinds them. And perhaps, you know, again, you know, they think Solomon maybe... You know, he would be immune to falling away from the Lord. Well, maybe a Pharisee would be too. Well, no, it's that problem of pride, and to realize, no, we've all sinned, we've all fallen short, we all have those sinful hearts, and that's what Jesus points out in the Sermon on the Mount. You know that, oh yeah, we haven't committed adultery. Well, guess what? You've lusted. Well, you haven't murdered. Well, maybe you haven't taken someone's life, but guess what? You've maybe harbored anger against someone. That's breaking the fifth commandment too. You know, Jesus leaves us without. He strips away that pride from us. And leaves us bare as the sinners with the evil hearts that we truly are. And so we see, well, we need a Savior then. We need a Savior from sin. We don't look to ourselves or trust in ourselves. We need a Savior. We need Solomon's son, the perfect son, who is going to come from Solomon's line, Jesus Christ. You know, one of the stories that came to my mind when I was preparing the sermon was John Bradford. He was a pastor, a Protestant pastor, late 1500s in England. So it goes back a while. Bradford, you know, for all the things that he did in his life, he's known for one famous quote in particular. The story goes, he saw a criminal being led to execution for their crimes. You know, someone who was clearly a criminal going away to be executed. And Bradford pointed to the guy and said, there, but for the grace of God, goes John Bradford. You know, sometimes we hear people say that, right? There, but for the grace of God, go I. That's where that line comes from, originally, at least.
I did not know that. I did not know that, Matt.
Yeah, kind of a neat background. You know, it's kind of become almost a cliche or just something we say now. But yeah, apparently originated with John Bradford. And I think, you know, he knew that he was no better, no less immune to sin than that condemned guy going to be executed. But for the grace of God, go I. And I mean, that really is the truth. It's all about the grace of God, and that grace of God shown most powerfully in sending his son, the perfect descendant of David, descendant of Solomon, Jesus Christ, to be our Savior. Talking about wisdom, that's where real wisdom is. Jesus is wisdom in the flesh. Paul talks about that in multiple places, but in 1 Corinthians, he talks about Jesus being the power of God and the wisdom of God. There's true wisdom. That descendant of Bathsheba and David and Solomon is the only one whose heart never turned aside, right? We're talking about being turned aside to other gods. That's the word that's used, the wording that's used there in 1 Kings that we looked at. And Jesus is the only one who never turned aside, never turned aside from the will of his Father. Didn't turn aside when he was tempted by Satan in the wilderness, didn't turn aside when he was ridiculed by Pharisees and others, or when he was in the Garden of Gethsemane in such anguish, still didn't even turn aside then. Didn't turn aside when he was on the cross itself, but willingly died, doing his Father's will, remaining faithful, didn't turn away. He did what we can't do. And again, but for the grace of God, shown in Jesus Christ, the only one who never turned aside, but for him go I. And that's what we recognize, whether we're Solomon and with his wisdom, or whether we're a couple guys on Rescue the Basics or whoever we are, it's not about us. We're not immune to sin. No, it's but for the grace of God shown in Jesus, go us.
And Matt, you had those passages from Paul that where Christ is the wisdom, and that's always been my contention. We tend to praise Solomon for his choice. Oh, give me this understanding. Yeah. But see, that's the problem. He wasn't looking for the wisdom of Christ. He was looking for an understanding, a human wisdom, an earthly thing. What he should have prayed for is what we all should pray for is faith, which is the realization, we are sinners. We are, of course, forgiven sinners. And in that forgiveness, we do remarkable things, surprising, shocking things, actually, considering what is in our heart in terms of love and care and trust. But again, that all comes from outside of us. That's not something that God has... we're still in the same sinful flesh, but we can go all the way back to what we had a few weeks ago, this picture in the Psalm, Psalm 23, that despite our sinfulness, there is this God who has goodness and who has the hesed, we love that word in the Old Testament, translated mercy, kindness, but best of all, probably steadfast love, that he's just coming after us. And if we know that, then we'll repent. I'm not saying we should do wrong. No, we need to recognize the wrong, repent of the wrong, but then understand, okay, the Lord's still with us, and the Lord's going to forgive us, and the Lord somehow can take that and make it work for good, which, he does. And we see that story over and over again in the stories we've had of all of these kings of Israel. But it has to come from that. It has to come from faith. It doesn't come from them. It doesn't come from their efforts of trying to be good. Because none of us can be good apart from what you talked about, apart from the grace that is ours in Jesus Christ.
Yeah, exactly. That's the focus. Not on how good of a person we are, not how wise we are, not how immune to sin we might think we are. Instead, we fix our eyes on Solomon's son, that perfect son, Jesus Christ. We focus on the one whose birth we just celebrated, the one who's laid in the manger for us. And, we confess before Jesus saying, but for your grace, Jesus, go I. That's who we fix our eyes on. In our Advent sermons and services, we end with an evening hymn usually most times. And one of the evening hymns we ended with was Abide With Me, not an Advent hymn, but an evening hymn. And I love that second stanza where it just says, I need thy presence every passing hour. What but thy grace can foil the tempter's power? I love that recognition. Again, not looking to ourselves, our own wisdom, or how good we are. No, it's not a thing of pride, but it's a thing of faith, like you said, John, and realizing that we need the Lord's presence every passing hour of every passing day. That's the only thing that's going to foil the devil's power. Fixing our eyes on him, trusting his presence and his grace.
And we're here at Wrestling with the Basics to remind people weekly that he is with us, and he is with us in his grace, and he is with us in his mercy and his steadfast love and his forgiveness. And you know what? There's not a thing you can do to stop him from being with you in all of those things, because it's not about us, but it is his very nature to be that way. Well, Matt, thank you again. This has been...
Wrestling with the Basics.
With the Basics.